I've always been a little absent-minded. I'm not sure if I got it from my honorable forefathers, or maybe there was just a bad planetary alignment the day I was born. Whatever. It's nearly cost me my life several times. The last time it happened, I'd gone to see Tony Marcos, a big-time trafficker I wanted information from in exchange for a film that looked kind of shady. How was I to know the idiot had got himself bumped off without warning me first? Under the circumstances, I thought I'd better not hang around at the scene of the crime. I hadn't reckoned with my absent-mindedness. And so there I was, wearing clothes that didn't fit right, on the run from a homicidal maniac. My only hope in hell? To run. Very fast.
Stop or I'll shoot!
Interesting. Time to catch some big fish. Okay, bring on the beast.
Hey, Buffalo Bill! Where'd you learn how to shoot? At the circus? Or didn't your mom teach you how to piss straight?
Thank you.
What's he waiting for? He doesn't expect me to show myself, does he?
You asked for it.
It's hardly a great haul, but it'll have to do. Looks like the door's been walled up.
Yes, it sounds hollow.
To the brim. Where's all this water coming from? All I need is to find the book this page is from.
You, man.
Uh-oh. I better be off before he decides to show up. There must be a way out of here. But I'm gonna have to risk my butt to find it. There be light. Red, green. Looks like some kind of running signal, but what for? Just needed a fuse to turn the lights on. The lift is going up. This looks interesting. Sweet music to my ears. The water must be emptying next door.
There's no need to run. I'll get you anyway.
Daylight at last. I took a deep breath of fresh air, already imagining myself sprawled out on my comfy sofa, a glass of my best whiskey in my hand. And yet I had to face the facts. As soon as they found my papers at the sauna, all the cops in Europe would be breathing down my neck. And when they hauled me in for Marcos's murder, I'd sooner go to hell and get help from the American embassy. No, I had to get out of these stiff's clothes before they began to really suit me. I got the spare key from the housekeeper and finally made it to my place to pick up the film. That roll of film was the only proof I had of Marcos's crimes, and I wasn't about to let anyone else get their hands on it, especially not a big jerk who decided to make himself at home when he wasn't even invited. Who's that guy sitting on my sofa using my phone? At last, the punk decided to leave me what was mine. This film would prove once and for all that LaGrange, the unscrupulous politician, and Marcos, the drug runner, were guilty. My brave guy act must have impressed old Fatso, because he literally vanished into thin air. He'd left a clue behind, though, which would lead me to him later. A book of matches he must have dropped during our scuffle. There were some odds and ends in Tony Marcos's pockets. A key, an electronic diary, and other stuff that would help me with my investigation. I called my buddy Didi, the computer whiz. This genius knows everything there is to know about everybody. I was sure he'd be able to make sense of my discoveries. I told him about my adventure at the sauna and the chase with Buffalo Bill. He suggested I tell him the rest in person. You never can tell who might be eavesdropping. Good old Didi. At the time, I thought he was being kind of paranoid. I couldn't even imagine anyone tapping my phone. But in fact, someone had been tailing me, watching my every move right from the start. I crossed town and went into Didi's dump. Unluckily for me, three tough guys were all prepared for the eviction officer to arrive, and through one hell of a mix-up, they thought it was me.
Come on, Betty, let's kick the crap out of them.
Oh, hell, there's no way out of here. I've got to hide. That won't do much damage. Pity.
Show your face, jerk. I'm gonna skin you alive.
Ready when you are, Betty, my sweet.
Come on, sucker. Come out and play.
One down, now for the next one.
What have you done to Betty? I'm gonna kill you when I get my hands on you!
Damn, a dead end. It's too late to turn back. I wonder if this switch still works. This electrical cable looks suspect.
Hey,
Max. Didi welcomed me in his normal cheery way and confirmed what I thought. The electronic diary was full of coded information, but it would take some time to decode. The key, on the other hand, came from one of the Buena Vista chain hotels, and there were now three of us who knew about it. The third thug from the dump had taken his revenge by ratting me out to the police, who were already after me since they'd found my ID papers at the sauna. Inspector Vandel sent his men racing after me as if his life depended on it, and soon all the sirens in town were coming down the street right at me. Even the stranger who'd been shadowing me right from the start suddenly dropped off the face of the planet. I had to find a way out of the neighborhood, which now, thanks to the cops, was completely surrounded. Vandel must have received the strictest instructions to find the killer fast, and someone somewhere had clearly decided to make me the fall guy. Yeah, but they obviously hadn't reckoned on dealing with Max Gardner, Houdini II. I shook that bunch of Boy Scouts off my trail as easy as if I were playing hide-and-seek at summer camp. I was beginning to feel like I was the hunter and the hunted. Right now, I held the clue to Marcos's hideout in my very hand. The key to room 227 of the Buena Vista Hotel. He told me the hotel was completely filled. Her name was Clarice. I was pretty sure that behind that angel face was a devious little thing. The girl in the back who answered to the name of Jenna was flattered by my interest, but she wouldn't say much at first. I could tell she was holding something back. The young lady told me that the girl in the next chair had stolen my key. My fake ID was working wonders. The little thief sheepishly agreed to give me back my key. I don't know yet who to call. The cleaning lady has obviously been told to guard the room. The young lady was glad to find the pearl Mr. Marcos had given her.
The room next door was empty. It had simply been reserved by phone.
I asked the young lady to distract the receptionist for a minute. I missed the boat. I asked my accomplice to distract her again.
I'd managed to ascertain from the register that room 227 was occupied by a lady, and that the next room was reserved in the name of a private club.
So it's a woman in room 227. Probably Marcos's lover. 225's reserved under the name of Club Zanzibar. Zanzibar. I know that name from Marcos's Odds and Ends.
Hello?
Club Zanzibar. At last, I've got the whole name and the right phone number. Club Zanzibar pretending to be from the hotel. Some guy named Sergio told me that room 225 was reserved for his boss, Mr. LaGrange. Paul LaGrange, the politician, of course. Boss at the Zanzibar. Thanks for the info. Lucky I didn't come across the closed mouth talk. I pretended to be Mr. LaGrange and canceled his reservation for room 225. Key to the room next to Marcos's. At last I was gonna find out who was in there. Called the person in the room next door. It seemed I had gotten her out of the tub. I pretended that I had the wrong number, and then I tried to check out the situation by doing a bit of smooth talking. She was pretty cagey, but I wasn't going to give up that easily. Now that I heard her voice, I was expecting an eventful evening. I ordered champagne for room 227 and waited for room service to come. The first time I saw Ada Wertmuller, a shiver went right down my spine. She had the kind of killer smile that could put you down and out for the count. Ada Wertmuller, a German ecological politics student fresh out of Karlsruhe University. Driven by her convictions, she had seduced Marcos to infiltrate his circle and sabotage his drug trade. She clearly had no idea he was dead. And I certainly didn't feel like being the one to break the news. In any case, I sure was crazy about her, and I wasn't gonna let anybody ruin this very special moment. Come to see my buddy Freddy, a newspaper columnist, to entrust him with my precious film. As soon as it was developed, everybody would be able to see that Tony Marcos, the trafficker, and Paul LaGrange, the politician, were in cahoots, and not everybody was going to like it. Freddy was an honest guy. He was determined to publish the photos even if it put his own family in danger. In the meantime, I decided to continue my inquiry at the Club Zanzibar, which, surprise, surprise, was run by LaGrange.
What is it?
How'd you like to earn a big tip?
Okay, Slick, let's see what you got. But don't get tricky on me. You hear?
He was so taken with the gold watch that he was almost friendly. After all, he wasn't against having a little company. I took advantage of his good mood to pump him for information. It sure wasn't going to be easy, though. Since I'd bragged that I was a good pool player, he challenged me to make three very difficult shots. Lou listening up, Sergio happened to mention there was another entrance to the club that led to a dead-end alley, and that the boss used this door with its three coded locks to slip in and out discreetly. Before the pool game was over, I'd managed to get the lowdown on LaGrange, thanks to Sergio. I went back to the hotel to be with my beautiful Ada, completely unaware another storm was brewing. Inspector Van Dale had put my description out all over town, and of course Ada had heard about it. She was an intelligent young lady, though, and I knew she wouldn't believe I was a murderer. From now on, we would be bound together by our mutual trust, and we were so eager to get to the bottom of all this that we weren't going to let anybody stop us. Not Inspector Van Dale, not anybody. That same night, we set out for Tony Marcos's office. I could hardly keep my eyes off Ada dressed in that number. She was the one who'd insisted we try to get her ex-boyfriend's secret documents. She was in command, and I was more than happy to take her orders. Sergio, the guy from the pool hall, would never have guessed just how useful his little gift turned out to be. Careful now. It's not in the bag yet.
Are you crazy or something? What are you doing?
Relax, it's an old Boy Scout trip.
Marcos's office is on the left at the end of the corridor.
Closed, of course.
Yes, but I know Marcos always kept a spare in the cupboard by his office. Oh, yes. I remember now. Marcos used to hide a copy of his office key here. It's somewhere around there. Can you feel anything?
Nope. Nothing that feels like a key anyhow.
Oh, Max, you're so clumsy.
Gotta cover our tracks. In. Marcos mentions the Grange on this brochure. Does that mean the politician is into guns? It's an IOU. The Grange owes Marcos a lot of money. Well now, a blank document with Marcos's letterhead on it. Seems kind of fishy. I'll hang on to that. Invisible ink. Interesting. An electric cord. It's my lucky day.
This is where Marcos kept his most confidential papers.
Okay, let's open it. Something needs to be connected here, but what? What does it have to be connected up with? Didi said he'd cracked the diary's secret code. It's your room number, sweetheart. So come on now, rack your brains. Damn, it's not that. Give me a hand.
Marcos was a sentimental guy, you know. It wouldn't surprise me if the password was related to his love life.
It was our lucky night. There was a whole file on an organization called the Elite sitting in Marcos' safe. I could already picture the kind of stuff the Elite must be involved in. Trading favors, political wheeling and dealing, all that. I was looking forward to a good evening going through the files back at the hotel. In the meantime, though, we had to get back out without being seen.
Max, listen. It's the security guard. He's coming.
Quick, hide. Like a door there. It works. We can close it with the magnet. This is the instruction manual for Marcos's watch and its secret mechanism. The Elite's three key members all had microfilm implanted here. This round room is the very nerve center of the Elite Research Institute. We'd managed to avoid the guard for the time being. Now, we had to get out of here without any hitches. Watch out, the guard's coming back. I couldn't believe the information in Marcos's file. Marcos, LaGrange, and someone named Kevork were apparently at the head of a totalitarian underground organization called the Elite. It was incredible. All three men had microfilm implanted under their skin, containing the access code to the Elite's secret database, which was hidden somewhere in a mysterious research institute. There was also a diagram of an electronic device in the file that reminded me of the watch I'd given Sergio at the pool hall. I let Freddy know it was much more serious than drug trafficking. The members of the Research Institute were knowingly using illegal products manufactured by Marcos under LaGrange's political protection. But what exactly was going on? That's what we had to find out. I decided to entrust my new partner with a delicate mission. Ada was to go to Marcos's warehouse where I'd taken the photos and find out the address of the Research Institute. Next, she had to try to get a sample of whatever it was they were making there.
Shoot! There's nothing going on here. The delivery man just moved an empty box. A postcard from the delivery man's girlfriend with his phone number on it. This might come in handy. There's nothing else under there. Ah, here's one of the products Marcos manufactures, especially for the Elite. A laundry ticket. Delivery man's called Mr. Felix. Huh, he's prepared for everything, isn't he? I don't have their numbers. The delivery man's called Mr. Felix.
You using a laundry ticket she'd found in the delivery man's coat, Ada pretended she was calling on their behalf. She asked for Mr. Felix and soon found out the number in the truck. Success. She found the address of the infamous research institute, the front for the elite's shady dealings, on a delivery slip.
Here's the address at the Elite Research Institute. Shouldn't be too hard to find. The number of the warehouse is printed on the slip. I guess it must ring through to the warehouse supervisor's office. There's another car parked at the other end. Must be the warehouse supervisor's. Here to search. The sunroof's open. Why not?
As soon as she'd found the number of the warehouse, Ada called the warehouse supervisor and left the phone off the hook, hoping to keep him busy. As soon as the warehouse supervisor answered the phone, Ada called the delivery man in his truck. Smart kid.
Warehouse. Hello? Hello?
In the end, the amazing Ada had the brilliant idea of putting the two receivers together, connecting the delivery man and the storekeeper. My darling Ada had done a great job. We showed Dee Dee the radioactive capsule she'd found along with the elite file. It was as clear as day to him. The organization was using the radioactive material to carry out genetic manipulations. In light of what Sergio had said about LaGrange's activities, Dee Dee advised us to plant a bug in his office. That way we'd be able to find out more about what he was up to. So there we were in the club. We sat where we'd be able to see LaGrange's arrival. Ada had gone to order more drinks when I heard footsteps and the sound of doors opening and closing in the direction of the office. That confirmed there was a second entrance via the back street. LaGrange clearly used it to come and go without being seen. A moment later, I saw a silhouette pass by. Then the light in the office went out. Something fishy was going on. I went into the dark office, and what I saw turned my blood cold. LaGrange sitting there with his hands soaked in ink, his throat cut. Before I even had time to react, the big guy I'd encountered in my apartment came bursting into the room. I frisked LaGrange's pocket and found a keyring like Marcos's and used it in the slot down by the floor. The secret passage opened, taking me out into the alley behind the club. Ada showed up at just the right moment. When she was at the bar, she'd heard gunshots coming from the office. She immediately rushed off to get the car and to get me out of there. The killer had struck again. The second of the elite's key men was dead. Was someone trying to get even with this evil organization? In the early morning hours, I noticed something weird. The ink stain on Ada's hand was strangely similar to the one I'd seen on LaGrange's hand. I was in a hurry to get the photos Freddie had developed. Ada would go and pick them up in the morning. She'd take a message I'd handwritten so Freddie would know who she was. There was a message from Dee Dee back at the hotel reception. He'd discovered that a certain Dr. Dramish had managed to get hold of LaGrange and Marcos's bodies, apparently, to do autopsies on them. The way things were working out, I began to wonder if it was a wise choice to come back to the hotel now that the cops and a bunch of killers were on my trail. I soon found out my hunch had been right when the receptionist informed me that Inspector Vandal had just shown up. He had a search warrant, so I had to think fast. I persuaded the receptionist to delay the inspector for a few minutes and started to look for the right hiding places. Okay, that gives me a few seconds to hide all the incriminating evidence I've got in my pockets. This bar is pretty empty. Ah, at last, a little Irish courage.
This label is hollow. I could slip something inside.
Marcos's false police ID will fit nicely under the label. What a great hiding place. I could slide something flat behind the mirror. Under the mattress. Perfect. I can hide something here. Bunch of dried flowers. Maybe I could hide something under this lampshade. Inspector Vandal came bursting into my room like a pit bull moving in for the kill. He tracked me down, and all he needed to pin Marcos's murder on me was some incriminating evidence. There was no way out. The police sketch was obviously of me, and the inspector sure didn't like meddling journalists. He searched me as roughly as possible, and, liking the idea of putting me away for 30 years, grabbed anything he found lying around.
You dumped the goods, didn't you? You just wait, old buddy, because I'm gonna sort you right out.
Phew, I'd won some time, but what was coming next?
Stop crying.
Furious that he hadn't found any evidence on me, but convinced I was guilty as hell, Vandal decided to stop being so nice. It didn't take me long to figure out that he was gonna kill me if I didn't find a simple but foolproof way out of this. If I go in there, I'm a dead man.
That's a brand new cover.
I was gonna have to play by their rules. This crooked cop sure wasn't gonna lose any sleep over killing me. One thing was clear, though. Someone high up with influence over the police wanted me out of the way. It had to be Kevork, the third man in the elite, and I had to find out who he was fast.
No! There's an undercover cop questioning Max's friend, Freddy. This is this morning's mail. That gives me an excuse to go into the office without making the cop suspicious. The water's evaporated. There's nothing left in the coffee machine. Max's message is now hidden in the mail. Finally, I'm here. I've got to get Max's photos before the cop finds them.
Ada calmly handed Freddy the mail where she'd hid my message. The inspector glanced at the pile just to check that all the envelopes were sealed, then turned his attention on my gorgeous accomplice's every move. He sure knew how to turn that sleazeball on. This gave Freddy all the time he needed to find my message. He pointed out a green file to Ada in which my developed photos were hidden. All she had to do now was get them out of the office. Moving fast while the inspector's attention was distracted by Ada's plunging neckline as she picked up the paperclip she'd spilled, Freddy boldly slipped the contents of the green file into the pocket of the inspector's raincoat.
Freddy actually put the photos in the inspector's raincoat. What's he got up his sleeve? Freddy must have something in mind. I'd like to have a word with him before I leave.
Freddy asked Ada to go make some coffee. He figured out how Ada could get the photos out of the inspector's raincoat. This gave Ada an excuse to leave the office. In a flash of inspiration, Ada spilled some coffee on Inspector Van Dale's raincoat. The very thought of it makes me shudder. Ada pretended to take the raincoat out of the office to clean it. She took the photos and stole a visiting card and some of the caramels the cop loved so much. We had both come up against Inspector Van Dale and had managed to outsmart him. This time, though, Ada outdid herself. She had that sleazeball Van Dale sewed up in no time. I had to take my hat off to her. I was happy as a pig in slop. I finally got hold of the photos everyone seemed so eager to get their hands on. Now all we had to do was to get the microfilm the mysterious Dr. Dramish had probably taken from the two corpses. At this very moment, in fact, Dramish was attending Marcos's funeral. I set out to stall a doc while Ada searched the private lab. He doesn't look exactly friendly. I don't think he wants to talk to me. It only took a drop of whiskey to get Mrs. Marcos's driver to talk. He told me that a private service was taking place. Only the deceased's wife and sister and a certain lady doctor were in attendance. And there's Marcos's big sister. Is that all the family the crooks got? Here comes our buddy, Marcos's girl. That's Dr. Dramish. So she's the one who did the autopsies on LaGrange and Marcos. She's only got one glove on. That's Dr. Dramish. So she's the one who did the autopsies on LaGrange and Marcos. He's officiating. Standard model. I think I can see something on the seat. It's smaller than Inspector Van Dale's. Dr. Dramish's other glove. This is definitely her car then. Now I need to put it out of action. A music score. Is Dr. Dramish a musician? Heart medicine. They can be dangerous if the dose is too strong. She won't get far like that. Out of the way. Let's see what Dee Dee's got to say. My oh my, you sure have left a trail of corpses in your wake. I hear LaGrange got himself bumped off too. Listen to this. Both he and Marcos had their throats cut with a sharp weapon, a knife, razor blade, or scalpel, by somebody left-handed. The bodies are at a certain Dr. Dromishus's place. I bet the doc wanted to remove the microfilms. Marcos' funeral is this afternoon. Dr. Dromish will be there. My plan worked. Ada will have plenty of time to look.
I'm here in front of Dr. Dramish's private laboratory. Now I need to get inside. It's a wooden stick. Closed, of course. There's a letter. It must have come today. It's a letter from an insurance company. I'll read it, then put it back. It's a letter from the Dear Doctor's Insurance Company. Let's see if the house is burglar-proof. It isn't very high. Easy enough for a young woman to climb. I can see a magpie's nest. I wonder if they really are thieves. I need to check the area out before I go any further. Okay, let's see if there are any hidden traps. Maybe I should check it out. Ah, there's the first camera. There should be two more. Thank you.
There's the second one. Only one more. Maybe I should check it out. Here's the third one. That's all of them. Check out what the thieving Mrs. Magpie's got. A key. Thanks to the insurance letter, I know where the three cameras are. Now I can get closer without setting off the alarm. Easy. The old key trick. Right. Here's the door to the devious Dr. Dramish's lab. Found an old tape player. I don't suppose these glasses were lying around by chance. Look like plans for an electronic cart. Let's keep them just in case. I thought I saw a wire in here earlier. Ah, here it is. Strange. The keys aren't numbered or lettered. Okay. Now that I've got these Polaroid glasses on, I can see the letters. I'm now in Dr. Dramish's private lab. Let's look for Marcos and Lagrange's grafted microfilms right away. Ah, a wire stripper. Right, that's where Dr. Dramish hides her little secrets. Now that I've stripped the two wires, we're ready for one hell of a short circuit. Great! It worked! The short circuit opened the safe. the microfilm. Didi was right. Both of them. Great. I've worked out how to decipher the codes. Right. That's Marcus's coat. That's LaGrange's coat.
The microfilm from Dr. Dramish's lab was pretty incriminating. The fact that Marcos and LaGrange had had their throats cut by a left-handed person with a very sharp knife was certainly suspicious. But what motive could Dramish possibly have? Didi and Ada decided to go for a stroll to mull things over. I stayed behind trying to piece this puzzle together. The screech of tires and the sound of a gunshot brought me back to earth with a thud. I leaped up and ran outside. Didi was lying in a pool of blood. The thugs had mistaken him for me. The only sign of Ada was her handbag. I grabbed it and ran. I had to think. I wandered alone for a long time before ending up in a gloomy restaurant where I tried to figure things out. I could smell Ada's perfume. And I began to relive memories of our relationship, memories which I now saw in a new light. Our first meeting, too easy. The feeling I was being watched right from the start. The ink stain on her hand, which proved as clear as day she'd been in LaGrange's office before me. Everything seemed to point to the fact that she was somehow tied up with the murders. When the knife slipped out of her bag, it only confirmed my suspicions. Was she really the murderer? Now I had to live with this knowledge and try to continue with my investigation. Suddenly, everything was even more complicated than before. I was lost in my thoughts when I was called to the phone.
Oh, you're Max Gardner, the meddling pencil pusher. You might still be alive now, but not for long.
I got the hell out of that restaurant and barely escaped with my life. I only got a brief break, though, because I was still carrying a transmitter in my pocket. When I figured out the glasses were bugged, I tossed them. I let the guy tailing me take a pleasant stroll after the garbage truck. I was through with being a target. I decided to go back to LaGrange's office where I'd seen his weapon collection. But in the alley behind the pool hall, I got sidetracked by an enterprising youth and his rigged card game. His rap started to get to me. I was just considering smashing the jerk's face in when I spotted Marcos's watch among all his crap. I decided to play it cool. I told the sucker I was Inspector Vandel. He was familiar with the inspector's reputation and offered me a free game. I hadn't guessed where the Queen of Diamonds was three times.
And two, and three. Gather around now, the watching's free. The cards are straight, follow the queen. Follow the diamond queen. Where's she gonna end up? Where's she gonna go? Seven of spades, not there. Eight of clubs, not there. Where's she at? She there? Is she there? Is she there? Is she there? Up, up, round they go, round they go. Where's the lady?
This one.
Ah, what a shame, but don't give up now. And one, and two, and three. Gather around now, the watchin's free. The cards are straight. Follow the queen. Follow the diamond queen. Ready? Watch carefully. She there, eight of clubs. Seven of spades. Come on, where's she going? Where's she going? Up, up, round they go. Nice and slow. Where's she gonna be? Where's the little lady now?
This one.
And a one, and a two, and a three. Gather around now, everybody. The watchin's free. The cards are straight. Follow the queen. Follow the diamond queen. Eight of clubs. Where's the queen? Seven of spades. Where's the queen? Is she here? Maybe. Is she there? Maybe. I don't know. Ready, concentrate. Up, up, round they go. Nice and slow. Here we go. Nice and slow. Where's the little lady now?
This one.
Ah, oh, what a shame, but don't give up now. And a one, and a two, and a three. Gather around now, everybody. The watchin's free. The cards are straight. Follow the queen. Follow the diamond queen. Eight of clubs. Where's the queen? Seven of spades. Where's the queen? Is she here? Maybe. Is she there? Maybe. I don't know. Ready, concentrate. Up, up, round they go. Nice and slow. Here we go. Nice and slow. Where's the little lady now?
There.
Ah, oh, what a shame, but don't give up now. And one, and two, and three. Gather round now, the watchin's free. The cards are straight. Follow the queen, follow the diamond queen. Is she there? No, seven spades. Where'd she go? Where'd she go? Up, up, round they go. Is she there? No, seven of spades again. Eight of clubs, where's she going? Up, up, round they go. Where's the little lady now?
It's that one.
Oh, not bad, just two more times. One, and a two, and a three. Gather around now, the watchin's free. The cards are straight. Follow that queen. Follow that diamond queen. There she is. Where is she gonna go? Is she there? Is she there? Is she there? Up, up, round they go. Round they go. And where is the little lady now?
Here.
Almost. Now don't get nervous. You're nearly there. And a one, and a two, and a three. Gather around now, the watchin's free. The cards are straight. Follow that queen. Follow that diamond queen. There she is. Where is she gonna go? Is she there? Is she there? Is she there? Up, up, round they go, round they go. And where is the little lady now?
That one.
Almost. Now don't get nervous. You're nearly there. And a one, and a two, and a three. Gather around now, the watchin's free. The cards are straight. Follow that queen. Follow that diamond queen. There she is. Where is she gonna go? Is she there? Is she there? Is she there? Up, up, round they go, round they go. And where is the little lady now?
There.
All right, one more time, buddy. And a one, and a two, and a three. Gather around now, the watchin's free. The cards are straight. Follow that queen. Follow that diamond queen. There she is. Where is she gonna go? Is she there? Is she there? Is she there? Up, up, round they go, round they go. And where is the little lady now?
It's that one.
Almost. Now don't get nervous. You're nearly there. And one, and two, and three. Gather around now, the watchin's free. The cards are straight. Follow that queen. Follow that diamond queen. Eight of clubs. Where's the queen? Seven of spades. Where's the queen? Maybe that's her. Maybe it's not. Up, up, round they go. Round they go. Where's the little lady now?
There. got the little crook off my back. And the watch if I wanted. All I had to do now was break into LaGrange's office. But there was another problem waiting for me. The access to the room seems to be controlled by a clockwork system. Finally managed to get a gun from LaGrange's collection. Thanks to what Sergio told me, I'd found the building where his men hung out. I knew I'd never be the same again after what was about to happen. I didn't give a damn who was who. I was driven by a thirst for vengeance. I was gonna make Ada's kidnappers and Dee Dee's killers pay. One by one. Deep down, without realizing it, I'd set Ada free so I'd get to the bottom of the things. How could she have played this obscene comedy, sleeping with me when all the cops in town were after me for the murders she'd committed in cold blood? How could she have strung us along with all that Dr. Dramish, the left-handed scalpel-wielding madwoman stuff, when she was the one who'd done them in? She explained that her father and brother, who were both attorneys, had been assassinated for pleading against the elite, and that she had to avenge their deaths. She said she loved me from the start. She was just trying to protect me by not telling me. In the meantime, though, my best friend had been killed, and it was all her fault. Ada dumped me there. Not only was she leaving me to prove my innocence to the police, but like a schmuck, I was left to confront Kevork at the Institute. It's a timer. They must use it for lab experiments. Hey, there's Dr. Dramish again with Kevork himself. At last I can put a face to the name and voice of the elite's brainchild. So, that little man with his silver cane is Kevork. Mastermind of the elite and founding father of this research institute, both of which he created to execute his evil plans. I get it now. It was thanks to Dr. Dramish's research that Kevork was able to carry out his illegal biological experiments. They have no idea I'm here. I have to find a way of taking them by surprise. I can place something on the ledge in front of this window if I want. I better not still be here when it goes off. My surprise entry gave me the upper hand, and I kept it. The doctor threatened to shoot, then just gave up. She launched into a lengthy explanation. No, she had never shared the elite's extremist views. She just wanted to carry out her research. She claimed that she never imagined what the outcome would be. She was finished with the elite. She was going to turn herself in to the police to put an end to the carnage. Kevork, furious about her confession, soon put an end to the conversation. He locked the room and filled it with poisonous gas. I could hear Dr. Dramish trying to say something. Moving closer, I caught her dying words, something about Kevork's microfilm. She managed to make a mark on the floor before she died. Tell you, there's nothing more touching in life than a reconciliation. I felt guilty as hell that I'd blamed Ada for my friend's death. She had swallowed her pride and come to save me. We were reunited against the evil elite. We moved to strike at their nerve center, the secret room. Hurry up, Kevork's coming with reinforcements. Looks like the shape of a watch.
Yes, but not just any watch, I bet.
This is the instruction manual for Marcos's watch and its secret mechanism. Happening. The watch fits perfectly, though.
security system only allows one person through at a time. Let's go.
Who do you think you are, entering my place like this? You're going to regret that move. Don't waste your time trying to be clever. You're my prisoners now. I suggest you start praying fast.
Don't worry. We're safe here in the secret room for the time being. The only way out is to find the information in this control terminal. Look and see if you can find any weapons. You never know. In the meantime, I'll try and figure out the terminal system, all right?
The remote control for the thermostat. This should heat things up a little.
Get back, you scum! Don't you lay a hand on it!
I think I've set off an explosion in one of the rooms. The solvents stored there obviously didn't appreciate the heat. Great. A laser. It can only be used once, so I'd better choose my adversary carefully.
Give up! It's pointless! There's no mercy for the likes of you.
It's nearly empty. There's still a little insecticide left. That should be enough for the three roaches after us. I wonder how safe we are here. Kevork and his men must be planning to attack.
If I fit all the pieces together, I'll have the schema for the electronic card.
Thank you.
I've pieced together the card's schema at last.
So, you're the woman who decimated my troops. Well, now you're going to die like your foolish father and brother who thought they could ruin my plan. For you meddling journalist! You shouldn't have gotten involved. You're not capable of doing this story. You just don't realize who you're up against. I am Lev Kavark, the sole survivor of a new order in this dying century. How would you like to join my laboratory rats? I need some fresh DNA. I'll be generous if you give yourselves up immediately. I'll make sure you don't suffer. Do you really believe you can destroy a lifetime of work? Your final hour has come. Prepare to die!
Ada, look up behind you. Oh no, she's been hit. Ada, are you all right?
Do you want Ada to die? After all, she's a criminal. Or should she stay alive? She did save Max.
No. Please don't die. You take too many risks, Ada. I swear the truth will get out. You can count on me. I swear. Rest in peace, Ada. How many deaths do you have on your conscience, murderer?
Contact. Insert card into player. Indicate the switch positions. Enter each code and validate separately. Correct code. Continue procedure. Correct code. Continue procedure.
Guess who showed up just in time to save my skin on the roof of the research institute? The incredible Didi. The bulletproof vest he'd been wearing had saved his life when I could have sworn he was riddled with bullets. Just goes to show how smart Didi is. He told me he'd been suspicious of Ada's undying love right from the start. As if it were odd that I should arouse such a sudden undying passion in a lady. What the hell? Anyway, he planted a transmitter in her lipstick as soon as he started to suspect her. The signal led him to the research institute. So what had become of Ada? Justice had been done. Her father and brother had been avenged. Now, she could rest in peace.
Don't worry, you'll be cleared. I sent the photos in the file to the people in the right places, and with your cassette, they'll soon get the whole picture. Now, if you want to know the finer details of the affair, just ask me. I've got the whole thing worked out. Like LaGrange and Kevork, Marcos the Trafficker was the other cornerstone of the elite. He was in charge of buying and transporting the crude radioactive substances from abroad. He refined them in his clandestine plants and then delivered the final product to the Institute. You photographed him with LaGrange in one of his warehouses. Ada killed him in the sauna where he had given you an appointment in the hope of buying back the film. Ada had only become his lover to kill him in the first place. LaGrange was the politician in the group. Kevork, who had detected his unscrupulous nature, brought him to the organization because he was politically high enough to suppress any legal action taken against the elite. LaGrange had contacted Marcos in the hope of buying arms for his collection. He then introduced Marcos to Kevork, thinking his trafficking skills would be useful. Ada killed him just before you found him in his office at the pool hall. Kevork was the brainchild behind the Elite, an official organization set up to stimulate an individual's potential. In reality, he was using his client's money to finance Dr. Dramish's research at the Institute. Her work was focused on genetically creating super-intelligent beings. Only he, LaGrange, and Marcos were capable of destroying the evidence in the event of a problem, thanks to the microfilm embedded under their skin. Dr. Dramish was the weak link in the organization. She'd been recruited by the Elite for her expert knowledge in biotechnology. During her research financed by the Elite, she discovered possibilities for controlling chromosome mutations by using radioactive substances. She was the one who implanted the microfilm and was responsible for retrieving them in the event of their deaths. The fact that she was left-handed made you think she was guilty of the murders. The Eraser, LaGrange's trusty henchman, was in charge of all the sensitive missions. His boss ordered him to follow you day and night. He was the one that shot at me instead of you once he traced you to my dump, thanks to the bugged glasses. Inspector Van Dale was on the organization's payroll. He received orders to eliminate you and Max because he thought you were the one who killed Marcos and LaGrange. He was ordered to cover up the whole affair because it got out and began causing trouble for the Elite. Ada had been planning her revenge for a long time. She had become Marcos' lover so she could kill him when the time was right. She killed him using her left hand in order to cover her tracks. Your arrival at the sauna after the murder was a blessing for Ada, because you immediately became suspect number one, leaving her in the clear. By pretending to help you with your inquiry, she was able to infiltrate the organization and get to the other leaders. That was when she killed LaGrange.
Do you want Ada to die? After all, she's a criminal. Or should she stay alive? She did save Max.
No. Ada, Ada, my love. Hang in there. Everything's gonna be okay. Don't worry, sweetheart. I'm gonna get you out of here. I'll go get help. Don't worry. I'll be back. Guess who showed up just in time to save my skin on the roof of the research institute? The incredible Didi. The bulletproof vest he'd been wearing had saved his life when I could have sworn he was riddled with bullets. Just goes to show how smart Didi is. He told me he'd been suspicious of Ada's undying love right from the start. As if it were odd that I should arouse such a sudden undying passion in a lady. What the hell? Anyway, he planted a transmitter in her lipstick as soon as he started to suspect her. The signal led him to the research institute. I suppose you want to know what happened to our relationship after all that. Well, it picked up right where we'd left off. Ada was alive, and the ambulance crew was taking care of her. She'd killed to avenge her family. I couldn't hold it against her that she'd rid the planet of two evil crooks.
Don't worry, you'll be cleared. I sent the photos and the file to the people in the right places, and with your cassette, they'll soon get the whole picture. Now, if you want to know the finer details of the affair, just ask me. I've got the whole thing worked out.